Good evening, and welcome on behalf of the Crossroads Cultural Center. The topic of tonight's presentation is the role of religiosity in the birth of civilizations. Archaeologists enjoy a particular and interesting perspective on the religious phenomenon. They can observe religiosity as it surfaced in the most ancient human societies, sometimes at the very dawn of history. They are thus positioned to offer original insights into fascinating questions that, for other scholars, can only be the object of speculation. For instance, what factors drove mankind's early religious expressions? How does the religious sensibility of those men and women compare to ours? And what was the role of the religious sense in the birth of ancient civilizations? This last question is especially interesting because for a number of centuries, Western culture has more or less taken for granted that material, economic, and geographic factors were dominant in determining the birth of the oldest historical societies, and that religious factors were secondary or accessory. Recent work, however, has called that conventional picture into question. Is it possible, for instance, that in some cases, religious factors did play a determinant role in the foundation of cities, and that the human search for meaning was, in itself, an aggregating and civilizing factor? To answer these questions, we have with us tonight two distinguished archaeologists who have done extensive field work, but who have also reflected deeply about the role of religiosity in early human societies. Dr. Giorgio Buccellati is Professor Emeritus in the Department of Near Eastern Languages and Cultures and in the Department of History at the University of California, Los Angeles. He founded the Institute of Archaeology at UCLA and served as its first director from 1973 until 1983, and where he is now director of the Mesopotamian Lab. He is currently director of IMAS, the International Institute for Mesopotamian Area Studies. His research interests include the ancient languages, literature, religion, archaeology, and the history of Mesopotamia, as well as the theory of archaeology. He has published a structural grammar of ancient Babylonian and is working on a detailed computer-aided system for excavation recording. He is also constructing a major website on the Urkesh excavations. Dr. Marilyn Kelly-Buccellati is Professor Emerita in the Department of Art, California State University, Los Angeles, where she taught ancient art and archaeology. She received her PhD from the University of Chicago's Oriental Institute. She is a visiting professor at the Cotsen Institute of Archaeology, UCLA. She is currently director of the Mozan Urkesh Archaeological Project and, together with her husband Giorgio, is co-director of the archaeological expedition to Tell Mozan Urkesh in northeastern Syria. Georgia and Marilyn have worked for many years in the Middle East, especially in Syria, Iraq, and Turkey. They work closely together, both in the field and on the publication reports from their excavations, of which five volumes plus audiovisual presentations have appeared so far. They have given joint lectures on the excavations and workshops on the methods used at major archaeological centers around the world. They have served as visiting professors in various European universities. And now, Professor Giorgio Buccellati.
Thank you very much, and thank you for coming on a night like this one. It is a pleasure to be here and to face an audience with very diverse interests. And we'll try to both meet these interests and to raise to the challenge of the presentation, which is in some ways daunting. that is to relate religion to the ancient world in ways also that are consonant with what our feelings are today. Because the broad Western imaginarium of Mesopotamian religion tends to be based essentially on the biblical perception of things, which is quite negative, because it is conditioned by both a disastrous political confrontation. Israel and Judah disappeared under the onslaught of the Assyrians and then of the Babylonians, and also a very explicit intellectual rejection on the part of the biblical authors. So tonight we will look behind this scenario with three assumptions in mind. First, the Mesopotamian was a valid and genuine human effort at reaching for and coping with the absolute. So there was something valid from a religious point of view, in contrast with the biblical perception. Our modern mental templates, on the other hand, are deeply rooted in that effort, much more than you might give credit to them for. And third, a noble look from a positive point of view at Mesopotamian religion, and especially spirituality, illuminates much better our understanding of the Bible itself. Now, to even speak of Mesopotamian spirituality may seem dubious at best, because the Bible is supposed to be spiritual, and Mesopotamia superstitious, again, the biblical bias. That is the pitfall that we want to get away from. And it was the goal of this book for that appeared last year to argue this case. So I'm referring what I've written there in Italian. It is in terms of the form of spirituality that Marilyn and I will take up this challenge tonight. For religion, as such, has actually played a role in the scholarship about the early civilization, not just the economic and other factors, in particular about the ancient Near East. But it has been religion as an institution that has been considered as foundational for the development of the historical development of the ancient Near East, as an institution. That is, as managing institutional skills and economic resources, not religion as a spiritual quest, which is what we want to highlight here. We begin by focusing on Mesopotamia in and of itself. And we must paint in broad strokes the general background before we come to deal with spirituality per se. So bear with me if I seem to take a long detour. It is worth it. Now, which more iconic document is there than the Code of Hammurabi, which is one of the few things about Mesopotamia that most people know? The part that I want to read with you is the very beginning, where the stage for the code is heartfully set. When lofty Anum, king of the Anunnaki and the Enlil, lord of heaven and earth, the determiner of the destinies of the land, determined for Marduk, the first son, firstborn of Enki, the Enlil functions over all mankind, made him great among the Igigi. So these are the various names for the gods. So it begins, this is the very beginning of the code. It begins with calling in question the gods themselves. And then it continues, when they called Babylon by its exalted name, made it supreme in the world, established for him that is for the king of Babylon in its midst, an enduring kingship whose foundations are as firm as heaven and earth. At that time, Anum and Enlil, the two gods named at the beginning, named me, to promote the welfare of the people, me, Hammurabi, the devout, God-fearing prince, to cause justice to prevail in the land, to destroy the wicked and the evil, so that the strong might not oppress the weak, to rise like the sun over the civilized people, and to light up the land. And then it goes on for, it would be another about 5 minutes of if I were to read it, with all the good things that Hammurabi has done. And then this long prologue ends, on that day, that is when I was called, and then it just begins, Article 1, if a man accuses another unjustly, and so on. It goes on for all the rest of the code. So the thing I want to point out is that the city comes first. The centrality of the institution colors the entire Mesopotamian mental template. In the creation myth, too, the city is created before man, before the first man, who appears almost as an afterthought, as if the city needed somebody to live in it. And it is the creation of the city as a political institution, not just as a settlement, the city as the state. And this is not casual nor accidental. So let's stress this importance of the institution in the Mesopotamian mental template. You see, history begins in the world, but especially in Mesopotamia, with the urban revolution. It had profoundly seared the human psyche at the threshold of history, around 3500 BC. And the city is not just a settlement larger than a prehistoric village. So you might ask yourself, what were these early cities? Not New York. Why do we call them cities? What is it that makes us closer to the first cities than an early city is closer to an earlier village? It's an interesting question. So the answer, in my view, is that the city is the locus where humans trade, the give up, face-to-face association for a bond, a social bond, that goes well beyond the realm of immediate perception, and something that I call the meta-perceptual bond. That is, a large number of people holds together, has a sense of solidarity, not because they know each other face-to-face, but because, like us tonight, I don't know most of you, but we are tied by some kind of a bond, which is, in this case, the interest in like in a certain topic. But the city as a whole is held together by this bond that goes well beyond the immediate perception we have with each other. And to be able to relate via these other mechanisms is fundamental, then, for the constitution of the state. It organizes the tasks that have to be done, and it leads people to identify with a space, the territory, where they live side by side. That's why the city is important, because it is the contiguity of residence that matters. Within this kind of social grouping, this first real society, as different from a mere community, that is, we lost something by not being a community anymore, by being a society, a city. Within this society, they developed the sense that human beings acquire value on the basis of their function, over and above their personal worth. See, we are important within an impersonal, anonymous setting like a city because we all perform a function and we all depend on somebody else doing that function. If I go to a city and they need a pot, I know there is a potter, even though I don't know the potter individually, personally. So this is the beginning of this, and then you begin to see also why this is so close to us today, the whole notion of anonymity and personality of the city, which makes us very efficient, but leads us also to lose the sense of personal interaction. So it is civilization. The civilization comes from the Latin word civis, the city dweller. And the race towards efficiency, towards city living, the race toward efficiency that was made possible by living in a city has never stopped, because it worked. The great strides towards ever greater technological progress began and never stopped ever since. Think of agriculture. The ability to connect the seed of today with the plant of tomorrow. Again, something meta-perceptual. The two things are not side by side. You have to make a link in your mind. And it's not necessarily a intellectual link, meaning that you actually theorize about it. That's why I call it perceptual, because there is a link that goes above the immediacy of seeing two things side by side in space or in time, but they're effectively linked. Writing was a breakthrough of even greater proportions, of really incalculable significance. It gave humans an entirely new way to relate to nature. It contributed more than anything else to the development of this metaperceptual bond. Why? Well, think, what is writing? It seems like a very simple answer, right? Because we all know how to write. But there is much more to it than you would think at first. It's not just communication of information. Writing allowed, for the first time, allowed humans to posit their thoughts outside their brains, to give a physical consistency, a physical reality to what was otherwise just in their brain. Articulate speech had done that already, but writing brings this to a much higher level, of course. And so communication is what really plays a major role here. It made it possible to crystallize the functional dimension of human beings, about which we talked a moment ago, as slots in a mental construct that now had a physical embodiment, the clay tablet. So the clay tablet is what's in my mind outside, and it makes it possible for me to connect all. When a tablet speaks of 60,000 sheep, it's something which cannot be seen in reality. You never see a herd of 60,000 animals together. Again, it's this meta-perceptual way of linking things that are linked only not in physical contiguity, but in some other way. And the state, as a political organization, was built on that. For centuries, the very first many centuries of the history of writing, almost the first 10 centuries, the only texts we have are documents for the administration of large organizations, truly urban or state organizations. Ever since, progress meant an ever greater capacity of control. Political control over the new social group was a major goal, but this was soon to be applied to the larger issues. How do we control nature itself? Well, we do so by analyzing it and defining the process of origin, how things have come into existence. And now we come back at the end of this detour to our original topic. Let us read, as I did for the code, and reflect on the beginning of the great Babylonian myth about creation, the Enumerilish. When on high the heavens remained unidentified and down below firm ground was yet without a name, the description of a formless matter. When only the primeval water, the progenitor, and the goddess of the sea, the universal mother, did blend their waters into one, ungirdled as to meadows, undefined by marsh reeds, the sort of primordial roiling in the formless whole or chaos, when no god at all was manifest as yet, none identified by name, determined as to personality, we still emphasis on the undifferentiation, then, out of within their midst, the gods were then created. The swamp gods first came to be identified by name. So it's the start of the differentiation, and it goes on from there. So there are two major themes here. The first is the taking shape of the formless. The beginning, notice, is not a beginning. It's not only that there is no word for beginning at the beginning of the creation, it's not mentioned as such, but we are in fact presented with a formless matter that does not have a beginning and that takes shape progressively. This is something that the original language expresses in ways that cannot easily be translated. I've sought to do so in my translation by stressing the static dimension that in Babylonian is expressed by predicates of condition, remained unidentified, without a name, ungirdled, undefined, not manifest, not determined. These words are repeated, and they're in the original language, very static verbal forms. And this is the formless matter that has no beginning. And just as there is no beginning, there is no becoming in the proper sense of the term. There is differentiation. There is transformation out of undifferentiation. So significantly, in the original text, the verbal dimension changes at that point. When I said then, it's when the verbs also change. From verbs of condition, they become, or forms of condition, they become forms of action, of movement. When were then created, they came to be identified by name, and so on. The rest of the long poem goes on to describe in full detail this progression of an ever greater differentiation. And the pinnacle of the process comes at the end, when the new supreme god, Marduk, is not just determined by name, as we have seen to be the case for the first gods, but determined by 50 names. The last tablet of the Enuma Elish lists in great detail 50 names of Marduk. So at the first, they had no name at all. The first gods are named, determined, manifested as to personality, etc. And at the end, we have 50 of them, 50 names. So his apotheosis is, we might say, the semantic or even the semiotic echo of the beginning, in quotes, that we just saw. Herein lies the genius of polytheism. Its spiritual dimension is in the development of an ambitious intellectual posture that has colored our entire mental template ever since. I will describe it with reference to three main characteristics. The point about there being many gods is much more subtle than it appears. You know, polytheism means many gods, but if we look at it superficially, it makes little sense, or rather, it doesn't really impress you very much. What it really means is that reality can be fragmented. The gods are icons of elements of the natural order, power, knowledge, justice, love, etc., that reflect the human ability to dissect and analyze. Fragmentation is ultimately a means of intellectual control to which the whole process of the urban revolution had led, founded as it was on the development of these meta-perceptual abilities. Our viewing the multiplicity of gods with a sense of superiority is misguided. Multiplicity means control of the parts, and the real contrast with monotheism is not many versus one, but the many, the numerables, versus the innumerable. In a sense, it's not many versus one, but if you want, many versus zero. This numerability of the fragments is encased in a matrix out of which differentiation emerges. It is, this matrix is fate or destiny, which is not generally included in a treatment of Mesopotamian religion because it is not a god. So there are no temples to fate. There are no statues to fate. There is no cult, technically, of fate, and so on. Therefore, it's not part of religion. But in effect, it is a foundational element of religion because it is really the Mesopotamian perception of the absolute that finds its shape in the sort of being or entity, the fate or destiny. It is the absolute seen as the sum total of the parts. We might say the genetic code of reality. In other words, it's everything that is already predetermined. It is totally self-contained, and I like to say homeostatic, in the sense of being impervious to any external interference. It is a self-contained system, and it is within it that differentiation unfolds of its own inertia, as we have seen very well described in that initial text, which is a very deep and profound statement about these sort of things. I'm putting sort of in our words what I think they were trying to say. Some may sound pretentious to think that we can say it better. But it's not that we can say it better. We can say it with our own terms, with our own type of mental template. The third characteristic is that the absolute, as a result of what I've just been saying, is predictable. Now, not that we don't predict it in the sense of knowing ahead of time or foretelling. So not predicting in that sense, but only in the sense that reality as a whole, the absolute in this sense of a almost a box, as it were, holds no intrinsic mystery to us. It cannot hold an intrinsic mystery. It only holds secrets. That's why I was saying it's not predictable. There are things that we are not predicting, but we're not predicting just because we haven't had enough time yet. Given enough, not because there is a basic difference of inability to reach this, the end of the line. Given enough time, it is in the order of things that we should be able to unlock all of these secrets. That's the mental dynamic of the Mesopotamian template as it developed over centuries, during which they assembled an enormous amount of not just data, but of observations, and astrology is one of the fields that's best known. And it sort of thing, you see, if you think about astrology, it requires a long commitment on the part of generations to observing celestial phenomena that are repeated. So it's not just a casual thing. It's something that's based on long-term scholarship and conviction that it's worth doing. So it's a very profound and committed intellectual exercise. Let us now revisit the creation epic, the Enuma Elish. It's called epic, even though it's really a myth. And let's compare it, really contrast it, with Genesis. This is what we read before. You see, Genesis begins outside of the box. There is a beginning. That's how the text starts. This is a slightly different translation than the normal one, it says. At that starting point in which God created heaven and earth. So in that starting point is the beginning. At that starting point, the earth was unshaped and deserted. Darkness covering the deep, the Spirit of God hovering over the water. So there is a beginning, and there is a formless matter, but which is within a box out of which God, as it were, is presented as looking at it. And then everything else is skipped, and we go down to the end. So God said, let there be light, and the light came into being. And God saw that the light was good, and it goes on with the narrative of creation. So in the biblical perspective, there is a beyond outside the matrix. And this is brought out forcefully by another portion of Genesis, which we can read as a parable. I like to, at least, that we together look at this other portion of Genesis as if it were a parable. A parable of the intellectual encounter between the two traditions, which was, I must stress, unidirectional. That is, the Mesopotamians had no inkling whatsoever of the profound spiritual travail that had taken place within their puny neighbor to the west. Israel and Judah were, in their eyes, no more than petty kingdoms of no importance whatever, politically or culturally, as it might be. So Mesopotamians had no idea at all about monotheism and about all that was happening in the Bible. But the biblical tradition did confront, openly, assiduously, even tormentedly, we might say, the powerful intellectual achievement of the great urban culture of the four riverbanks, the twin rivers. I would like to read it, to read in this vein, namely as a critical assessment of Mesopotamia, in fact of polytheism in general, the narrative of the original sin. That's the parable. In the Garden of Eden, God enjoined man not to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, otherwise he would surely die. The tempter gives a different explanation. They would not die. Rather, he says, the serpent, your eyes will be opened, and you will become like gods, knowers of good and evil. And that's what happens. Quote, the woman saw that the tree was good to eat and pleasing to the eye, and that it was desirable for the knowledge that it could give. So she took some of its fruit and ate it. And what happens? She doesn't die. There is no fire and brimstone. Nothing happens. The food is not poisoned. The opposite. What happens is a very noble and beautiful human gesture. She gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate it. I mean, what's, you know, more nice than sharing a meal? So it's exactly the opposite of what the foreboding what God had said. Now, there is a result, though. There is something that happens. Their eyes are open. So which is what the tempter had said, they do become like gods because they know more than they did before. They analyze, they can distinguish good and evil, and they take on the trappings of civilization. They're dressed, they put on clothes, which is interpreted by the writer as a covering shame of nakedness, but which in fact is in the Mesopotamian tradition is a sign of civilization. When Enkidu in Gilgamesh becomes civilized, the first thing he does is to put on clothing, because he now has become a human being, the text says. It's one of the most beautiful Akkadian sentences. He became a human being. So it is, in effect, the original sin, the discovery of civilization, experimentation and control of natural phenomena, eating the fruit, the enrichment of human dimension, sharing it, the sharpening of analytical powers, distinction between good and evil, the refinement of social living, the clothing. But there is a loss, a great loss, the death that had been announced. It is face-to-face association with the absolute, who cannot be so fragmented. The original sin, in this sort of reading of the text as a parable, is the invention of polytheism. What biblical monotheism proposes as alternatives are polar opposites to the three great characteristics of polytheism. The absolute cannot be fragmented, we do not live in a homeostatic box, and God is not predictable, but is rather and truly the living God. You see, the notion of living God acquires a whole new dimension seen in this perspective. So the genius of polytheism had been to propose rationality as an explanation, as a breaking down, fragmenting, analyzing. But, so goes biblical logic, it had gone too far by applying it to the absolute. The genius of monotheism is to propose rationality as interaction with the core of an absolute that beckons from beyond. That was the death announced, the loss of a face-to-face association with a personal absolute. If that is the original sin, then history, in a biblical perspective, is the recovery of that interaction. The Mesopotamian longing for a cultural conquest is valid. It's what we all do, after all. And after all, in Genesis, man names the cattle, the birds, the fish, but it doesn't name God. There remains, in the biblical perspective, the longing to go beyond the conquest of naming and to accept in addition to conquering or imposing. This gap, the gap and the distance between humans and the beyond, was sensed in Mesopotamia as well. So it's not that they were rationalists to the point of not longing for the absolute in similar ways, but it was obviously not resolved in terms of the biblical experience. So their effort took on many other different phases, their effort at bridging this distance. And to this, Marilyn will introduce us now.
Exactly, bridging the distance. How is it that Mesopotamia approached the divine? Well, they approach the divine partly by imaging their deities, imaging them because that responded to an inner spiritual urge that they had. And the images reflected their ancient experience of the world. So the sun, the moon, the rivers, the mountains, they are imaged in this way. This is a seal from the British Museum, owned by a scribe. You can see the inscription there, owned by a scribe Ada. And the imagery here is right after the inscription. I think you can see there. There's some kind of a hunting god. We don't have his exact name. And then there is Ishtar. So the deities are named in Mesopotamia, as Giorgio pointed out. She is a female. She's the most important. Here she is, if I can get the arrow there. There she is. She's the most important female in the Mesopotamian pantheon. Right next to her is Shamash. He is the sun god. And he is seen here coming forth from the mountains. So he has a saw in his hand and is coming forth from the mountains. He has rays coming from his shoulders because he is cutting the night as he comes forth. Then the next major deity here is Ea. And Ea is the god of wisdom and god of the sweet waters. So from his shoulders you see these streams of flowing water that is alive. So with the fish encased in the waters. And then the last one is Usima, who is a deity that has two faces. So looks forward and backward. Not one of the major of the pantheon, deities of the pantheon, but still an interesting one. This is a seal of the impression of a seal showing Ishtar, this very important female goddess. And she is depicted with the lion. That is one of her symbols. And another a part of her symbolism is these weapons that come from her shoulders. And we found in our excavations at Urkesh a seal impression of Ishtar with the weapons, but in this case another symbol of Ishtar is the date palm. And in our seal impression she's with her date palm. So many, many images, very different images of these various Mesopotamian deities. Now we're going to go on to the place of the worship of these various deities. And rituals are, of course, an extremely important mechanism for contacting and interacting with the deities. And the ziggurat, probably all of you have seen the pictures of these various ziggurats, and the temple towers are the primary locus of these rituals. And well, this is the ziggurat of the moon god at Ur. They have restored it, but I want you to look. So it's a high platform. The temple was on top. We don't still have this temple. But I want you to see the emphasis on the stairway. So the emphasis is on the ascent. Even if many people didn't actually go on this ascent, the emphasis is on the ascent and the fact that you can see the ascent from below. And we're going to see something from our own excavations connected with this. And then this is the wonderful Bruegel, who is viewing here the ziggurat of the temple. The Tower of Babel, and which is actually the ziggurat in Babylon. From our own excavations, we can see that we are excavating a mound that was a sanctuary from the mid-4th millennium BC. And clearly by the middle of the 3rd millennium BC, and probably earlier, Urkesh was one of these first cities that Giorgio was talking about, and it developed, this city developed around this initial sanctuary. This is our mound, or tell in Arabic, from afar, and you can see how very lush the landscape is. In northern Mesopotamia, there is a lot of rainfall. And so a great emphasis on the agriculture of the area. And in the background, you can see the mountains of the Turabdin in Turkey. So as we have excavated the site, we've excavated the site for 25 years now. So you can uncover a lot, but there's always still a lot to uncover. But one of the places we uncovered is this monumental temple mound, as it were, with a plaza in front and escarpment, a very nicely preserved revetment wall with a stairway. Remember we talked about the ascent, and a glacis leading up to the temple on the top. And in this case, we do have the foundations, at least, of the temple on top. And so that was a reconstruction drawing, and so now we want to see from a kite photograph what some of these things are. So we have the temple and the revetment wall and the stairway that you can see from the kite photograph. And here we have the temple of the lion on top of this temple mound, as it were. Now, these walls are reconstructed because we only found the foundation of the walls of the Temple of the Lion. And we call it the Temple of the Lion because we did find a lion statue in the temple, but we actually think that it was dedicated to the chief god of the, or one of the chief gods of the Hurrian pantheon, whose name is Kumarbi. Because our city is a Hurrian city, at least by about 2200. It is clearly a Hurrian city ruled by a Hurrian dynasty. And Hurrian texts, which are preserved later in the Hittite archives. The Hittites had a great respect for Hurrian religion, and Hurrian religion had a great influence on Hittite religion. Sort of like the Greeks and the Romans, the relationship of the Greeks and the Romans. And the Hittites preserved a great number of Hurrian texts written in Hurrian in their own archives. So in these archives, Kumarbi lives in Urkesh. So Kumarbi is the main god of the city of Urkesh. And since we think that this is the main temple of the city of Urkesh, we don't have any inscription, it would be nice, but we have, we think that the temple is then dedicated to Kumarbi. And since we are in the north, you may think of Mesopotamia as only having mud brick architecture, which is usually the case. But since we're in the north, we have a lot of stone in our area, not too far from us in the base of the mountains of the Tor of Din, those mountains that you saw, which are in modern day Turkey. But there were all kinds of seasonal streams that ran out of those mountains in the Tor of Din with which they could float down stones. And so we know where the quarries are. And we see that they learned early on to build with stone as well as mud brick. And in fact, as we have a stone wall that is a revetment wall, we think, for this temple tower, temple mound of the fourth millennium. And so, but the stone wall that we see now, the stone walls that we see now are, the stone wall. This is the revetment wall, and here is our staircase. And right beside the staircase, on the west, there is these steps. So it's like an amphitheater here. There are two of these steps for every one of these. So it is as if you could either be on these steps and watching some procession, probably that's coming up the stairway from the plaza, or else there could have been some ritual actions on these steps, this part of the apron, we call it. There could have been some ritual action on the apron. And one of the stones, this very large one here, looks as if there was something special going on in this part. So there may have been an interaction in the procession. Unfortunately, we don't have any texts which actually talk about this, but it seems quite logical. And notice that the stairway is protected on the east side by this wall, and at this moment in the excavations, we haven't excavated in front of the wall, but in this one you can see that we have excavated in front of the wall, and there are two orthostats there. So again, pointing the way, the ascent in this stairway is extremely important, and so we have some women in the local dress walking up the stairway. And one very interesting note is that on this stone, on the side of the stairway, there is a very smooth place. A smooth place where you would think, well, if you're walking up that stairway, you could touch right here. And so we had our geologist look at this stone, and we said to him, is this something that was made purposely at one point in time, or is it something that happened over time? And he said, it's impossible that it was made at one point in time. It must have been worn smooth by people walking up the stairway and touching it. So that gives you the shivers when you come that close to these ancient processions, let's say. So we have this major temple and the major access to the temple. And we also are very fortunate in having structures that are connected with the netherworld. And I want to first show you a tomb that we excavated, and read you a poem that matches the appearance of the grave. So this is a tomb. Of course, you know, in any excavation you find lots of tombs, but this one was particularly well preserved. It dates from about 1800 BC. Wow. And the tomb, we think, is really reflected in this poem of the descent of Ishtar. So it's our Ishtar that we saw before, the descent of Ishtar into the netherworld. So the poem starts by saying, to the land of no return, the world below, Ishtar, daughter of the moon, set out to go. Daughter of Sin. Sin is the deity, the name of the deity connected with the moon. The daughter of Sin set out to go. She went to the world of darkness, where Irkala dwells. Irkala is one of the names of the netherworld. To the house from which there is no exit, on the road from which no one returns, to the house where no light glimmers. So it sounds very much like the tomb. Where one survives on dust, and of course, that is what you have in these graves. One eats but clay. Again, very much the condition of these graves. Where light is gone and darkness reigns. Where clothes are feathers like those of birds. Where dust forever settles on door and vault. And, you know, where the clothes like feathers, we didn't understand until we excavated this tomb. And when we excavated this tomb, and this is a picture taken shortly afterwards, you see here, there are the clothes, the dust of the clothes, as it were, seem to be like feathers. And interestingly enough, very soon after we excavated this, material disintegrated totally. So you had to be there at the moment of excavation in order to see what this poem was actually referring to. We are also fortunate, so we can connect the poem with the grave, but we are also fortunate in Urkesh, to have another vehicle for communicating with the netherworld. And this is very specifically Hurrian. This doesn't happen in southern Mesopotamia. It only happens in northern Mesopotamia. And we're going to see, interestingly enough, one episode in the Bible. So this is a great necromantic structure at Urkesh. And so we have looked already at the temple on the top of the mound. You haven't seen the palace of Tupkish. Tupkish is the Hurrian, one of the Hurrian rulers of the site around 2250 BC. The great plaza we've seen before, the temple, and now we are going to see. So this is the reconstruction of the temple, the temple mount. There's also another stairway built later. So this is the main stairway we saw, and then there's another stairway over on the west side that was built quite a bit later. The palace and this lower sacral area, the a structure that is in Hurrian called an abi. So these are the various buildings that we've seen. And here is a palace, the palace of Tupkish, with these shelters, because in the palace of Tupkish, the foundations are, and to some extent the wall above ground are made out of stone, but then the walls are made out of mud bricks. So they are conserved by shelters, and there you can see them. And then there is the necromantic structure there right beside it. And the necromantic structure was there earlier than the palace, because the southern wall of the palace was stepped back so that the structure was there previous to it. And the structure is lined with these stones. And it is very impressive. It is, the circular part is 5 meters across, and it is 8 meters deep, but we haven't gotten to exactly the bottom of it, so it is probably deeper than these 8 meters. And always lined in various phases, always lined with these stones. Now, the access to it was with a stairway, and the stairway was very narrow and very steep. And when we first excavated it, there was a stone here preventing access to the stairway, either from the top or from the bottom. And the reason that you don't find these structures in Mesopotamia is that in Mesopotamia, they never tried to contact the deities of the netherworld, any deities actually. They communicated by patterns, and we're going to read a poem at the end talking about these patterns in the entrails of animals that were important for determining what the will of the deity was. But in the Hurrian world, you ask the deity questions, or you ask that, we're not sure in the Hurrian world whether they asked ancestors questions, but we know later on that ancestors could be asked questions. So this is a space for a structure for calling forth the deities of the netherworld. Now, you don't want the deities of the netherworld to go roaming around, because they gave you illness, they gave you bad dreams, they made you do all kinds of terrible things. So it's very dangerous, these spirits. So the stairway is narrow, remember, it is very steep, and there was a stone at the top of it. Now, inside our main structure, there are circles, so magic circles, and it is because of these circles and the fact of the the kind of animal bones that we had in there, that I was able to determine the function of this building, that is, that it's a Hurrian abbey. In one of the rituals that takes place in the abbey, and this ritual we know always from the Hurrian texts in the Hittite archives, they say, take two daggers, which were made along with a statue, this is about a new statue, of the new deity, and with them dig a pit. Now obviously you do not dig a structure 8 meters deep with a dagger, but you can make circles. You can make these ephemeral circles, and we had a lot of these ephemeral circles within the pit. We didn't find too many offerings that could be termed ritual offerings, but we did find several, and one of them is this little vessel of a nude woman, and she has a small vessel on top of her head. And one of the ritual offerings for the abbey was a little bit of perfumed oil. So that could have been one of the functions of this lady. And she has this distorted mouth. Otherwise, she's pretty realistic. But she has this distorted mouth because in the text, the dead speak in a strange way, difficult to understand them. Another ritual object was this vessel in the form of a pig or a boar, and we do know that the boar was a very important symbol in Urkesh, because this is a seal impression. It's not such a wonderful one, but you see how difficult it is working with these seal impressions of the queen seated here, and you know that's her because of her inscription, and under the inscription she has a boar. So in an important place on her seal, she has this boar. So pigs were important in the abbey. Now, okay, so we know that this is quite important in the Hurrian world, but we do see a reflection of this in the Old Testament, and specifically in the Book of Samuel, the famous story of Saul and the Rich of Endor. To set the scene for a moment, Saul, his chief prophet is Samuel, and Samuel has died, and he needs to go to war with the Philistines. The Philistines are amassing on his border, so he needs to do something about it. But he needs to contact Yahweh in order to that he sanction this war against the Philistines. And none of the minor prophets who are working now for Saul is able to do this. And so Saul becomes quite anxious about this, and so he finally says to his servants,